Good day, viewers. We thank God for the grace we have to always sit and learn at the feet of Jesus as we continue in our Bible study series. Remember, our theme is being in the name of Jesus Christ. And we are introducing a new something 8 today, which says the head of the church. Our specific topic for consideration will be Jesus Christ, the head of the earthly church. We are grateful to God and excited to have in the studio our fathers and the Lord who will help us look at this very important topic, especially at a time like this. Jesus Christ, the head of the earthly church. By my right is the Right Reverend Professor Dapo Asaju. He is the bishop's theologian in our communion. Welcome to the program, my Lord. And then by my left is the Right Reverend Ephraim Ikako. He's the Lord Bishop, Anglican Diocese of Amici. Welcome to the program, my Lord.
God bless you, viewers.
Our aim today will be to define the Church of Christ on earth. Secondly, to show that the Holy Spirit was sent by Jesus Christ to establish the Church at Pentecost. And finally, to establish the fact that no human on earth have the right to claim the ownership of the Church of Christ. That's important, that no human on earth has the right to claim ownership of God's church on earth. Before we build deep in the discussion, we'd like to take our background text. My Lord, sir, I'll encourage you to help us read Numbers chapter 29:35-37. My Lord Bishop of Amici. Matthew chapter 16. We would like to take it from verse 16, the verse before the 17th verse, verse 16 through to 19. And I will take Acts 1 to 12 and 37 to 41. Let's read all those scriptures and build a proper background for the discussion. My Lord, sir.
Yeah, Numbers chapter 29, beginning at the 35th verse. On the eighth day of the festival, proclaim another holy day. You must do no ordinary work on that day. You must present a burnt offering as a special gift, a pleasing aroma to the Lord. It will consist of one young bull, one ram, and 7 1-year-old male lambs, all with no defects. Each of these offerings must be accompanied by its prescribed grain offering and liquid offering. You must also sacrifice one male goat as a sin offering in addition to the regular burnt offering with its accompanying grain offering and liquid offering. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. My Lord, sir, Matthew chapter 16:16-19.
Matthew chapter 16:16-19. Simon Peter answered and said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Jesus answered and said to him, "Blessed are you, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. And I'll read quickly from the New King James Version of the scripture, Acts chapter 2, 1 to 12. When the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven, as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and one sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and began to speak with other tongues, as the Spirit gave them utterance. And there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven. And when this sound occurred, the multitude came together and were confused, because everyone heard them speak in his own language. Then they were all amazed and marveled, saying to one another, "Look, are not all these who speak Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each in our own language in which we were born? Parthians and Medes and Elamites, those dwelling in Mesopotamia, Judah and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya, adjoining Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, we hear them speaking in our own tongues the wonderful works of God. So they were all amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, whatever could this mean? Verse 37 to 41, quickly. Now, when they heard this, they were cut to their hearts and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Then Peter said to them, repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is to you and to your children and to all who are far off, as many as the Lord our God will call. And with many other words he testified and exhorted them, saying, be saved from this perverse generation. Then those who gladly received his word were baptized, and that day about 3,000 souls were added to them. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Introduction quickly. The word church is derived probably from the Greek word kurieton. That's the Lord's house, which was used by ancient authors for the place of worship. In the New Testament, it is the translation of the Greek word ekklesia, which is synonymous with Hebrew kahal of the Old Testament. Both words simply mean an assembly. The visible earthly church consists of all true believers throughout the world that profess faith in Jesus Christ. It was born at Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit sent by Jesus Christ came and baptized the believers into one spiritual body. This means that this position is reserved exclusively for Jesus Christ, and no believer on earth has the right to the headship or ownership of the church. I think the introduction is quite self-explanatory, but we are trusting God that as we discuss further, that God, by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, will help us understand deeper what he will have us learn at this season, in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
My Lord, sir, in the context of Numbers chapter 29, 35 to 37, where you took earlier, you read for us, and Acts chapter 13, 1 to 4, that we may need to read now. Acts chapter 13, 1 to 4, I'll quickly read. Now, in the church that was at Antioch, there were certain prophets and teachers, Barnabas, Simeon, who was called Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Manian, who had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch and Saul. As they ministered to the Lord and fasted, the Holy Spirit said, now separate to me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them. Then, having fasted and prayed and laid hands on them, they sent them away. So being sent out by the Holy Spirit, they went down to Seleucia, and from there they sailed to Cyprus. In the context of this scripture and the earlier one in Numbers, how can you define the church, my Lord?
Thank you very much, sir. The church is a special group of people that were called out of this world to the marvelous light of Christ.
Yes, my Lord.
The church, we all know, is not just the establishment. The church is not the denomination. From these two scriptures, we take the New Testament one first, the Acts of the Apostles. Some say the church was back at the point of Pentecost. That's not true. It was only formally inaugurated for a new dimension of its own era.
Yes, my Lord.
The church actually is rooted in the Old Testament.
Yes, my Lord.
Theologically, Jesus Christ is the second Adam, where the first Adam failed. The church is the new Israel, where the old Israel failed. The
awesome.
Origin is simply this. In the beginning, all was well. There was a rebellion by Satan. God threw him out. Man failed. God caused man. And after the causes, problems and calamities happen. Okay, it's calamity. Noah's deluge that killed everybody. Babel, confusion. So God was fed up. He said, I've made a pronouncement I can't take back. He said, the day you commit this, you will die. So he had to pay the price because man had no capacity to pay the price.
If you look at
the text in this Old Testament, God was talking about sacrifice that was holy without any blemish. So God called Abraham in the Genesis chapter 12. There were four promises he gave to him: the promise of land, flowing milk and honey, promise of seed, uncountable descendants, promise of greatness more than other nations. But the most important one, he said, I will bless those who bless you and curse those who curse you. And through you, all
the nations of the earth
shall be blessed. The model of God was to choose a man, raise him up as a nation of priests,
reveal to that man, given the word, and they will go out to go and mediate that salvation to others.
Awesome.
Jesus confirmed this in Matthew chapter 28:19. He said, go to all nations and preach the gospel. It was the Abrahamic mandate, which the Israelites, in their own ways of segregating Gentiles from the Jews, didn't do. So Jesus came. So the church actually is the saved people who have mediated the salvation of God, the presence of God, revelation of God, who will now take it out to save a world that is going to hell. Because it's a very deep thing. So the church is not a recent phenomenon. Jesus came as a result of the prophecies of the Messiah who was to come and initiate a new dimension to actualize it. So
awesome.
If you look at the New Testament Acts of the Apostles rendering here, church in this context, and not just those who are saved, but by those who are being sent by the Holy Spirit. They laid hands on them, they commissioned them, and the power of the Holy Spirit, they go out to carry out the work of mission. The basic issue there is mission. If you go now to the numbers that we saw, the church is a worshiping community. First, the church is a missionary community. The second is the church is a worshiping
community
of holy people. Peter said it, you are a chosen generation,
a royal priesthood,
a peculiar people, a holy nation, called out of darkness into the marvelous light of Christ, who are not a people but now the people of God. So we are a mystery. We are just heaven on earth.
Awesome. That's deep. My Lord, sir, your take on this?
Yeah, in addition to what the Prof has said, we can quickly add, has laid the basic foundation of what the church is. It's not a recent development, a recent organization, but a product that has started from the New Old Testament.
Yes, my Lord.
And God is a God of purpose. He's a God of principle. He's a focused God. He has something to achieve in man. When he said, I want to create man in my own image. That is a replica of God. A representative of God, an ambassador with full authority.
Yes, my Lord.
But just as we saw in Genesis chapter 3, the failure started. So I can simply add there that the church is a body of saved people from the life of sin, disobedience, rebellion to God, unto the life of obedience, yieldedness, and commitment to the mission of God, just as he mentioned. The church is for a mission. It is not a sitting church, it's a going body. And you know, since we started having issues with the standard of the church and body of Christ, since we started adopting the sitting down church strategy, instead of going out church,
mission strategy.
You know, when you go out on mission, like these people we are sent in Acts here, you go there, minister to a sinner, he knows or she recognizes his or her sins, confesses his sin, receives Jesus, he's coming into the church now as a saved person, cleansed person, sanctified.
Awesome.
Then you begin to nurture the person. But now we sit down, they come as they are, contaminate the church, and you are struggling to even find your identity. So the church is a going church for mission and for salvation of souls.
Awesome. Thank you very much. I'm excited at the depth of this background that we've built. I trust that the Holy Spirit also will begin to explain it to you and input it in your heart for you to have this understanding that you are called out. You are the church. You've been called out to go out on a mission. Our God is a purpose-driven God. My Lord, I still say with you, from the incident in today's text, that's looking at the experience in Acts when the church was empowered for a new dimension, like the bishop's theologian told us, can you identify the foundation of the church of Christ? You help us read again. Matthew chapter 16:16-19. For emphasis, we need to read that revelation that Peter caught. And then I'll read Acts chapter 1, verse 8, and then we'll take your submission, my Lord Bishop. So.
Matthew chapter 16:16-19. Simon Peter answered and said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus answered and said to him, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I also say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it. And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth is bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth is loosed in heaven.
Acts chapter 1 verse 8. But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem, and in all Judah and Samaria, and to the end of the earth. From these accounts in these scriptures, and then relating it to what happened in Acts chapter 12, the Pentecost experience, what is the foundation of the church, my Lord Bishop, sir?
Yeah, if you look at, let me start this way, every structure, every building, and everything you want to build, foundation is very important.
Yes, my Lord.
Once you miss it at the foundation level, you are embarking on a very monumental, risky venture. So when we look at the church and we look at the confession Peter made in Matthew chapter 16, verse 16, Jesus was asking them, who do men say that I am?
Awesome.
They now told him the versions of men about him. He said, okay, you've been following me. Who do you say I am? And Holy Spirit inspired Peter. I said, you are. You can mark the definition there. And he used the definite article, they. He didn't just say, you are Christ. But he said, you are the Christ. He comes again to say, the Son of the living God. So if you look at that, it is on that condition and that confession that Jesus said, on this foundation of your confession, I will build my church. So Jesus is the foundation of the church. The Holy Spirit, being also the third person of the Holy Trinity, is also the sustaining power of the church. And you cannot have any other foundation like we read. We may still see it, 1 Corinthians chapter 3. He said, for no other foundation can anyone lay except that which is already laid. And he said, that is Jesus Christ. So in summary, the church, the foundation of the church is Jesus Christ himself,
awesome,
the Son of the living God.
Thank you very much, my Lord. You know, my Lord, my struggle now, in practical terms, having known this foundation, what is happening to the church of today, even maybe in the context of our country, Nigeria, is it that someone is missing a revelational understanding of this foundation? That's why there seems to be crisis. I'm not just talking denomination, and I'm not just talking with reference to Anglican communion. I'm talking generally. Why do we have to have this crisis of identity, so to say, that we don't know that Jesus is the bedrock of the church?
Well, the gospel is about Jesus Christ. If you look at the Old Testament dispensation, the time of Christ and the time of the Holy Spirit, the Trinity have always been there. At the point of creation, in the beginning, God, the Spirit brooded over the darkness, and the Word of God, the creative agent, was there. At the point of the baptism of Jesus Christ, he, the Son, was the one being baptized. Holy Spirit came like a dove, the voice of the Father came.
Spook.
So we need to balance the Trinity. What is happening in the churches today is that doctrinally and theologically, people are deviant from the balanced gospel. They take one of the three and they just emphasize on that. And the Pentecostals are emphasizing more of the Holy Spirit anointing, and they are missing out with the cross of Christ. That's the reason why the hymns we sing still keep making sense to us today. Christ is the center.
Christ,
the Father foreshadowed him. The Holy Spirit came to fulfill him. He is the center. And if we only are Christocentric, if we allow the gospel of Christ, the model of the life of Christ, to guide us, then we'll be true Christians. The church is a community molded after Christ. We are called Christians because we are supposed to be like him. It's because we have departed from this idea, because of sensational theologies and doctrinal exploitation and commercialization of the gospel, and adulteration of the gospel with strange powers. People are seriously deceived. And I thank God for the Anglican Church. We are still solid by the grace of God. We have our own little problems here and there,
on the gospel. Awesome. Anglican Church is scripture based and we're balanced.
Awesome. Awesome.
Like the Jehovah's Witnesses, they hold on to the Father. The Son does not have the place. We have the Father, we have the Son, and we have the Holy Spirit.
Awesome. Christ is our cornerstone. On Him alone will be yours. Child of God, will be back in a moment to continue the discussion. I'm excited and I'm getting blessed. God bless you. I just want to tell you what I think about
you. Hello. We are starting a new series of episodes on the show Youthful and Purposeful. It promises to be impactful, insightful, enlightening and refreshing, far beyond the ordinary. We know that you've been looking for an avenue to learn deep, satisfying truths in simple and precise terms that are easy and refreshing to the mind. And that's why we've packaged this show just for you. Join me as we glide through the wisdom that is far beyond this world, one that money cannot buy, yet free, liberating and exciting. The youth will find purpose, passion and drive. Even the aged will regain their youth. It's going to be an outpour of doses and doses of electrifying energy. Sure, you're not going to miss it. See you there. And I'll be your host, Sanctified Akko.
Welcome back. Remember, we've been looking Jesus Christ as the head of the earthly church. And God has been blessing us immensely via the ministry of our fathers and the Lord who are with us in the studio. Once again, by my right is the Right Reverend Professor Dakpo Asaju. Welcome to the program, my Lord.
Thank you very much.
And then the Right Reverend Ephraim Ikako. Welcome once again to the program.
Thank you. God bless you.
Now we look at question 3. My Lord,
yes,
state the main reason the Church of Christ has survived the test of time. The main reason, and this question is, it's as if among several reasons, they want you to pinpoint the one, but we look at those after we read the scriptures. You help us with Acts chapter 5. 34-39, and then my Lord, Ephesians chapter 2, 19-22. Then we'll take your submissions afterwards.
Thank you. Acts chapter 5, let's take it from 33.
Yeah.
When they heard this, the high council was furious and decided to kill them. But one member, a Pharisee named Gamaliel, who was an expert in religious law and respected by other people, stood up and ordered that the men be sent outside the council chamber for a while.
Mm.
Then he said to his colleagues, men of Israel, take care what you are planning to do to these men. Some time ago, there was that fellow Theudas who pretended to be someone great. About 400 others joined him, but he was killed and all his followers went their various ways. The whole movement came to nothing.
Mm.
After him, at the time of the census, there was Judas of Galilee. He got people to follow him, but he was killed too, and all his followers were scattered. So my advice is, leave these men alone.
No.
Let them go. If they are planning and doing these things merely on their own, it will soon be overthrown. But if it is from God, you will not be able to overthrow them.
Hmm.
You may even find yourself fighting against God.
Hmm.
This is the word of the Lord.
Ephesians chapter 2. Thanks be to God.
Ephesians chapter 2, 19-22. Now, therefore, you are no longer strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, having been built on that foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom the whole building being fitted together grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are being built together for a dwelling place of God in the Spirit. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. So my Lord, the main reason why the Church of Christ has survived the test of time?
The main reason is because we are not of this world. The agenda is not our agenda. We are not in control. He is. He is the one who called. He is the one who came. He is the one who died. He is the one who is coming again.
Mm.
He is the one who commissioned us. He is the one who empowers. He is the one who mandates us. He is the one running the church. He is the head of the church.
Mm.
He is the chief executive officer of this church.
Ah.
And he had already said that the gate of hell will not prevail against the church. He has given us a word of assurance. No matter what they do, there is nothing they can do. The church is going to survive all persecution.
Mm.
And it has survived all persecutions in all eras. In this text, we could see that highly respected man, Gamaliel, the same man under whom Paul
learned,
telling them, look, if it is of God, you cannot overcome these people. Others who came on their own, they were not sent by God. and they fizzled out.
Mm.
But if these people are of God, you better just leave them. Otherwise, you will find yourself really fighting God. And can anybody fight God? We are of God, and we are peculiar. We are peculiar. There is no other name given under heaven where we can be saved, except the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. So the uniqueness of Christ is supposed to be our joy. We are the only ones who know where we are going if we leave this world. Death has no meaning to us. It's just transition to a better life. We are here to live and to work for Him. So we survive because we are of Him. He's the one running the church. The church may fall away. God will regather it.
Awesome.
Yeah.
My Lord.
Yeah. Furthermore, you look at, I mentioned something when I was talking before about foundation. Where we read in Ephesians, it just went further to buttress and expatiate and give a robust explanation by not just saying Jesus is the foundation, but it's a chief cornerstone. There are things, you know, every professional career has its own word syllabus. If you meet civil engineer and those that are into construction, they can give you the assurance of this word, cornerstone. So, and you look at the church, Jesus, who is indestructible, unconquerable. He does not change with time or season. He is not in the program of men, rather he controls the program of men. He said it was impossible for even death to hold him. This is the head of the church, the foundation of the church, the chief cornerstone of the church. So as a result of that certainty, that is why the church in everything, like God, when we are talking about the Anglican church, we believe the entire scripture. You know the experience of Moses in the burning bush? He said he saw the bush burning, but it was not consumed. That was an Old Testament representation of the church. That this crisis will come, these pressures will come, that the world will pummel us, but it will not consume us. Because the chief cornerstone is Jesus Himself.
Awesome, awesome. Bible says we are hard pressed on every side, but not forsaken. Struck down, not destroyed. Persecuted, not abandoned. See, always having in our body the mark of the dead, so that the excellency of His life will be manifested in us. I'm excited that nothing can ever destroy the church.
Yeah.
I read a book. It says the Chinese church that will never die. One literature. The Chinese, the chronicled persecutions that Christians of that era went through. But as we speak, Christianity is still in that land. Albeit, maybe, not many, but there are Christians in that land.
Yeah.
You can never fight the church. Rather, you'll be seen to be fighting against God. Be encouraged. And then, my Lord, as you were speaking, there's something the Holy Spirit just ministered to me. You know, Gamaliel told them, if God is in this, if God is in this, child of God, I can assure you, if the hand of God is upon that matter in your life, go and rest. God will fight all your battles. So for those of us who are in ministry, who are in church, if the hand of God is in it as the chief cornerstone, no matter what men say, we will keep on keeping on in the name of Jesus.
Amen. Amen.
From your experience, my Lord, now, from your experience, are there some people who claim ownership of the church today? Maybe let's read 2 Peter before we take that response. 2 Peter 2, 1 to 3. You help us read that.
Yes.
2 Peter 2, 1 to 3. We'll take that question and then we'll take the B part of it. Is there really anything like a church founder? Justify your answer with 1 Corinthians 3. 9 to 11. Let's take 2 Peter first. 2 Peter 2.
2 Peter chapter 2, 1 to 3. But there were also false prophets among the people, even as there will be false teachers among you, who will secretly bring in destructive heresies, even denying the Lord who bought them, and bring on themselves swift destruction. And many will follow their destructive ways, because of whom the word of truth will be blasphemed. By covetousness they will exploit you with deceptive words. For a long time their judgment has not been idle, and their destruction does not slumber. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Let me take 1 Corinthians chapter 3, 9 to 11 quickly. For we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field. You are God's building. According to the grace of God which was given to me, as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation, and another builds on it. But let each one take heed how he builds on it. For no other foundation can anyone lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. So let's take the questions A and B first. Are there people who claim ownership of God's church today, my Lord?
Okay. Looking at what is happening in the contemporary times, the answer is concretely in the affirmative. So many, let's use the word that is in vogue, big men of God. Big papas, general overseers, bishops, man of God. But you know, they have come to the point of what we have now in the Church of Jesus Christ, which is suffered for, redeemed by his blood. Now we have what we can say personality cult. We are, everything we do as servants of God now is drawing our attention to the man of God and not to the Christ, the owner of the church. So because of that, now you can hear people coming up and say, this is my church. You cannot do this in my church. I own this church. I established this. I founded this church. So it's a rampant thing now, though very embarrassing and very disturbing, that somebody can come up and say, I own this church. It's not possible. Jesus is the owner of the church. In the church, there we have God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. That's the triune God establishing his temple, especially in us. So it is very unacceptable. And I need to talk to some of us, all of us viewing, that we need to watch it now. You hardly see many Christians here who will say, the scripture said. It is this bishop said, prophet said, man of God said, papa said, our mommy said. Because people have replaced themselves, replaced Christ with themselves. And as a result, what we are raising now is followers of the man of God, not disciples of Jesus Christ.
Awesome.
Because of this claim that we have not openly said, I am the owner of the church, but by our actions and activities, there are people, and many of us are guilty of placing ourselves far above Christ, the owner of the church. When you tell, I'm going to see a man of God, that's good, but what are you pointing the people at? So we really need to be careful, especially our people, who run around a lot without checking foundation or what they're looking for.
You know, my Lord, as you are contributing, it takes me back to one of your messages. I think the church in Crete, the hijacked church.
The hijacked church.
Yes. I remember, you say, certain men have crept in subtly. Yeah. I listened to that message from you. And that seems to be what is happening. The church seems to have been hijacked in our time. We are men replace the God of the church with themselves, personality cult, like the Lord Bishop said. Now, my Lord, is there anything really like a church founder? Let's justify that answer with what we just read in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 9 to 11. I think it's the experience of Paul and Apollos, one watered, one built.
Yeah.
Do we have anything like church founder?
There is no thing like church founder. It's an aberration to regard anybody as a founder. We are all servants. The Lord Jesus Christ. You cannot be more Catholic than the Pope, as they say.
Yeah.
You cannot be more Christian than Jesus Christ. Yeah. Our calling is humility. Our calling is service.
Awesome.
All this bravado and all these ears around us and this bigmanism is very, very erroneous. And we have to be very careful. There is nothing like that. It's our duty to call people to the truth of the gospel. We are departing from the faith. Let me make this very important point. Yes, there is absolutely nothing new about the gospel and about the church apart from the Lord Jesus Christ who came to die on the cross. Nothing. Salvation concept has always been the same. The same heaven, the same hell. You're talking about rapture now that people are still doubting, but somebody in the Old Testament was taken by a vehicle up to heaven.
Up to heaven.
Jesus raised the dead. Elisha also did. And Jesus walked on the water. Moses parted the water. Jesus fed 5,000. Moses fed millions. There is absolutely nothing. And talking about being born again, that if you give your life to Christ, your name will be in the book of life. The book of life had been in operation since the time of the Old Testament. Moses spoke about it. If we not forgive these people, remove my name from your book. He was aware there is a book of life. So the principle has always been the same. If you are in the Old Testament, if you believe in God, Yahweh, it's the same Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Any of the three, you are still believing in God. Is this is salvation by faith through the justification of our faith. It's by grace. Principles have never changed apart from Christ. So the church is an embodiment of all the principles and the teachings right from creation, from Genesis to the end. We must be very careful. It's an old institution. Therefore, we who are just mere mortals can't claim to own it. We don't. We are just playing our role like Shakespeare. You play your role and you get out. If they are that powerful, how come we didn't save the power during this COVID-19? Everybody was humbled. Where are the Pentecostal big men? They all shut down. Those who are gathering in their millions now, they are all confined to their tables and preaching. Where is now? Then they're changing their gospel. We have lost the power. The church is a powerful institution. It's a heavenly institution on earth. And we have departed. We need to get back to the simplicity of the gospel.
My Lord, I think we need to stay on that as we summarize. What can the church do, I'm asking now, to get back these powers of old? Or have we missed it that there is no hope for us again?
God has never changed. If you follow the biblical principle of doing ministry, we'll get back to it. It's very simple. People have come before us, they've given us examples. Genuine birth, getting back to the Lord, getting back to the gospel, doing proper mission and demonstrating the power of God. The gospel is so full of power, and that is why we keep surviving. Because we have the only license to get to heaven. They don't. We have information about what afterlife looks like. They have no idea. We have opportunity of transformation of life. They cannot. We have the gift of forgiveness of sin. We can even be quitting. Christ gives us the power to absorb sin. They don't have that. We have the power to heal, to raise the dead. Our ministry comes with supernatural power because of heavenly backing. They don't have it. We are unique people. If we rediscover ourselves, we'll be doing ministry the way they did it in the apostolic times.
Awesome.
We need to get back.
Awesome. Jesus say, greater things you will do because I go to the Father. Faith of our Father's holy faith will be true to it to the very end. Your last word, my Lord.
Yeah, my last word is that we are considering Jesus Christ the head of the early church. And I want to advise all of us, both the leaders of the church and the followers, two things we must do. Let's heed the word of Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 16.
Yes, sir.
And if I may read it, it says, Jeremiah chapter 6, 16 says, thus says the Lord, stand in the ways and see, and ask for the old paths, where the good way is, and walk
in it.
And look at their response. Then you will find rest for your souls. But they said, we will not walk in. Do you know why? This is describing the present generation of Christians. So I want to suggest, if we want to experience the power of God again, we must go back to the old ways.
The ancient landmark.
There is no new cross. It is the same cold, rugged cross. If you miss it, you have missed it. If Christians and Bible teachers and pastors and us can go back to raising disciples and not solution seekers. What we have all over the denominations are solution seekers.
Miracles.
Not even magic seekers. Because if you must experience miracle, you follow God's principle. Miracle is anchored on principles. But magic has no principle. So if we must experience, like Prof said, when I look at Jesus and his disciples and all that came, our apostles, Paul never organized miracle crusade. Miracle is in the mission field. Go to the market, evangelism, go into vehicles, buses in Lagos, in Abuja, anywhere, start preaching. You will know you have the power to open the eyes of the blind. But you sit down in the comfort of the church, come, Jesus will make you walk. That's not the pattern of the scripture.
Awesome.
Let us raise Christians who will now take the gospel to the society, to the marketplace, to the motor parks. Let us stop this feeding bottle Christianity.
Awesome.
And we are doing now. And once we begin to do it and go back to a life of holiness, ministers of the gospel become humble, humble. Many of us are so arrogant. We put our hands in the pocket to preach and pray as we are talking to our classmates. If we go back to the principle of the scripture and doing God's work in God's church, miracle will be spontaneous.
And will experience that power as of old.
Okay.
He made his ways known to Moses and his acts to the children of Israel. Choose where you want to belong. Conclusion. Various religious leaders may have founded physical churches or denominations, but only Jesus Christ is the founder of the church, which is his body. He purchased us with his precious blood. Food for thought. Jesus Christ, the founder and sustainer of his church. We take the memory verse together. Ephesians chapter 2, 19 to 20. We'll read it together from the Sunday school outline. Ephesians 2, 19 to 20. We'll read together.
Now, therefore, you are no longer strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone.
Christ is our cornerstone. On him alone will build. We thank God for today. It's been an explosive time in his presence. What an awesome time it's been learning at the feet of Jesus. Like I always say, if there is any instrument with which we will grow as Christians, especially in this era, where men are being tossed to and fro by every wind of the doctrine, if there is any instrument with which we do that, it is via the Word of God. We thank God for today, and we are most grateful to our resource persons, our fathers and the Lord, the Right Reverend Professor Dak Masaju. It's always a joy to have
you. Thank you.
May God continue to increase you.
God bless your ministry.
The Right Reverend Ifrani Kako, it's such a joy to have you.
God bless you.
Pray that the boundary lines continually will fall unto you in prison places.
Amen.
And that your exploit for the kingdom, especially in this end time, will not be in vain.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Child of God, our commitment under this channel, the Advent Cable Network, is to make sure that the undiluted word of God is taken to the utmost ends of the earth. You want to partner with us on this assignment, on this side of eternity. There are numbers scrolling on your screen now. Our social media handles are right now showing now. You can get back to us and give us feedback. Constructive feedback that will help us build on what we are doing. Until next week, when I'll see you again, you are the church. You are the light of the world. Go and show forth the excellencies of him that has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. God bless you.